In July of 2001, Portugal officially decriminalized all drugs. The punishment for being caught with anything from heroin to methamphetamines to marijuana became mandatory rehabilitation, or at worst, a small fine. No jail time. So what did Portugal's drug decriminalization actually do? Well, in the late 90s, Portugal was dealing with a serious drug problem. Rates of AIDS among drug addicts were higher than anywhere else in the European Union. Although there were fewer drug users overall, there was a much higher proportion of addicts among those users. Portugal's effort to reduce the harm caused by drugs through decriminalization had some interesting results. Despite hopes that the rates of addiction would fall, the Cato Institute noted that in the last decade and a half, drug use rates have actually stayed the same in Portugal. Many detractors feared that the country would become dependent on drug tourism, but that didn't happen either. Instead, Portugal has seen a significant decline in sexually transmitted disease, overdoses, and rates of HIV and AIDS. The clearest explanation for this shift is a combination of two forces: a governmental push toward treatment options instead of jail time for addicts, and a lack of stigma or punishment when seeking help for drug issues. This is known as harm reduction, that is, an acknowledgement and regulation of the problem rather than the usual practice of outlawing it, followed by punishment and jail time. Many have touted Portugal's experiment as a step towards the way we look at drug addiction by stressing that it is a health issue, not a crime. Portugal's success with decriminalization may provide a framework on how to solve drug problems in other countries. Just in case you haven't heard, our brand new channel, Seeker Stories, is the place to go for all the untold stories, inspiring footage, and beautiful introductions to the world around us. City Verite is a collection of love letters to the urban landscapes many of us call home. Check out that video in the description below, and don't forget to subscribe for more. Thank you, as always, for watching Test Tube. We appreciate the support. Please subscribe.
Decades ago, the United States and Portugal both struggled with illicit drugs and took decisive action in diametrically opposite directions. The U.S. cracked down vigorously, spending billions of dollars incarcerating drug users. In contrast, Portugal undertook a monumental experiment. It decriminalized the use of all drugs in 2001, even heroin and cocaine, and unleashed a major public health campaign to tackle addiction. Ever since, in Portugal, drug addiction has been treated more as a medical challenge than as a criminal justice issue. After more than 15 years, it's clear which approach worked better. The United States drug policy failed spectacularly, with about as many Americans dying last year of overdoses, around 64,000, as were killed in the Vietnam, Afghanistan and Iraq wars combined. The number of Portuguese dying from overdoses plunged more than 85%, before rising a bit in the aftermath of the European economic crisis of recent years. Even so, Portugal's drug mortality rate is the lowest in Western Europe, 1/10 the rate of Britain or Denmark, and about 1/50 the latest number for the U.S. It's not a miracle or perfect solution. But if the U.S. could achieve Portugal's death rate from drugs, we would save one life every 10 minutes. We would save almost as many lives as are now lost to guns and car accidents combined. Methadone and other drug treatment programs also exist in the U.S., but are often expensive or difficult to access. The result is that only 10% of Americans struggling with addiction get treatment. In Portugal, treatment is standard. Portugal switched to its health focus under the leadership of a socialist prime minister named Antonio Guterres, and if the name sounds familiar, it's because he's now the United Nations Secretary General. The new approach was a gamble. We were facing a devastating situation, so we had nothing to lose, recalled João Castelbranco Goulo, a public health expert and the architect of the policy, our national hero, as one Portuguese cabinet minister told me. So let's be clear on what Portugal did and didn't do. First, it didn't change laws on drug trafficking. Dealers still go to prison. And it didn't quite legalize drug use, but rather made the purchase or possession of small quantities, up to a 10-day supply, not a crime but an administrative offense, like a traffic ticket. offenders are summoned to a dissuasion commission hearing, an informal meeting at a conference table with social workers, who try to prevent a casual user from becoming addicted. In the first year or so of decriminalization in Portugal, there did seem to be the increase in drug use that critics had predicted. But although the Portuguese model is often described simply as decriminalization, perhaps the more important part is a public health initiative to treat addiction and discourage narcotics use. My take is that decriminalization on its own might have led to a modest increase in the use of hard drugs, but that this was swamped by public health efforts that led to an overall decline. Portugal introduced targeted messaging to particular groups: prostitutes, Ukrainians, high school dropouts, and so on. The health ministry dispatched workers into the most drug-infested neighborhoods to pass out needles and urge users to try methadone. At big concerts or similar gatherings, the health ministry sometimes authorizes the testing of users' drugs to advise them if they are safe, and then the return of the stash. Decriminalization makes all this easier, because people no longer fear arrest. Decriminalization also made it easier to fight infectious diseases and treat overdoses. In the US, people are sometimes reluctant to call 911 after a friend overdoses for fear of an arrest. That's not a risk in Portugal. In 1999, Portugal had the highest rate of drug-related AIDS in the European Union. Since then, HIV diagnoses attributed to injections have fallen by more than 90%, and Portugal is no longer at the high end in Europe. One crucial mistake that Portugal did not make was to follow the United States in adopting prescription opioid painkillers for routine use. Adalberto Campos Fernandes, the health minister, said that Portuguese doctors resisted overprescribing, and that regulators also stood in the way. Another factor that has benefited Portugal: the economy has grown and there is a robust social fabric and safety net, so fewer people self-medicate with drugs. And Case and Angus Deaton of Princeton University have chronicled the rise of deaths of despair, and argue that opioid use in America in part reflects a long-term decline in well-paying jobs for those with a high school education or less. Portugal initially was scolded around the world for its experiment as a weak link in the war on drugs, but today it's hailed as a model. The World Health Organization and American Public Health Association have both praised decriminalization and a public health focus, as has the Global Commission on Drug Policy. One attraction of the Portuguese approach is that it's incomparably cheaper to treat people than to jail them. The health ministry spends less than $10 per citizen per year on its successful drug policy. Meanwhile, the U.S. has spent some $10,000 per household, more than $1 trillion over the decades, on a failed drug policy that results in more than 1,000 deaths each week.